96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
The Revolution with Juan McCartney is sponsored by Alive, BTC, Burger King, Commonwealth Bank, Girls Will Be Girls, J.S. Johnson, Marco's Pizza, NUA Insurance Agents and Brokers, Popeyes, Rev Bahamas, Ross Electric Motors, Wendy's, and CMR Productions.
Good afternoon, Bahamas, and welcome to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Sorry about the late start. You had some technical issues, and now we're ready to go. Issue solved. Okay, so let's start off with BTC would like to advise customers that we've commenced a disconnection exercise. BTC has easy and convenient ways to pay your bill with MyBTC app, online banking, BTC Virtual Store, FastPay, or call BTC at 225-5282 to stay connected with BTC. If you hadn't paid your bill, they're going to be disconnecting you before the end of the year, so go ahead and pay your bill. I pay my BTC bill with FastPay. It's very convenient. I'm going to call nobody. All right, so we're going to talk today about a couple of things. So we're going to talk about this IDB report that's digging into post-pandemic recovery, talking about the price control measures and why the government's approach is not the correct one. We are also going to speak with some folk from the Junkanoo community, Saxons to be specific, coming in today in the second hour. What happened? You want them? You tell your valley people to come, no problem. You in the valley? Yes, man. What are you doing? Why did you stop being in the valley? It just happened. You never was in the valley. You was. What's your roots now? Nothing. You. What it is? Model? I have no idea who that is. That's a B group. What happened? Yeah. No? All right. Don't worry. The valley ain't coming out till the sun come up. So... they last. Everybody can be at McDonald's by the time the valley pop in. All right, so we're going to have some folks from the Saxons come on in. That's going to be interesting to talk to them. They're doing some different stuff this year than they have in the past. But before we get into all of that, I want to tell you that the Sam Bankman-Fried has finally, officially dropped his fight for extradition. So he has told Magistrate Shaka Seville that he's ready to go. He's going to waive his right. Shaka Seville said he's going to inform the minister responsible for extradition that SBF has waived his right to an extradition hearing and has been committed to custody pending extradition to the United States. Bankman-Fried told Seville that his decision to end his fight against extradition was not forced. His lawyer, Jerome Roberts, said SBF is anxious to leave, and if it's done today, that's fine. The United States wants him extradited to face fraud and other charges connected to the collapsed cryptocurrency exchange. So he's probably going to be gone today. The plane has been at the airport since, I believe, Friday. I think it's an FBI plane or Department of Justice. One of them, federal, U.S. federal government is they're going to go take him and make him nice and comfy in a U.S. federal prison until he can be taken to court and arraigned on charges. They got a lot going on. So that's the end of that part of the FTX saga in the country. He's not going to be here, and he ain't coming back. Well, you never know. I don't know if he's going to... If he beats his case, then he could possibly he'll be back, because he does have all that stuff in Albany if they don't sell it all off and elsewhere. Now, if he gets convicted, he's facing up to 155 years in prison, which, you know, just give him life and be done with it is the wise thing to do to me. You know, like, no need to hang up. Doesn't make any sense. So he's gone. All right. We have with us a report from the IDB, Caribbean Economics Quarterly Report. This is for December 2022. This is what the IDB put out there, and it discusses several countries: Barbados, Jamaica, Trinidad, and where else? Barbados, Jamaica, Trinidad, Bahamas, Barbados, Guyana, Jamaica, Suriname, Trinidad, and all of Latin America. Okay. So we're, well, Jamaica's in a worse off position than we are, as is Barbados. Well, Barbados is an IMF program. Their balance of payments is way out of whack. Now, about us, they're looking at how we're recovering from the pandemic. And they talk about the policies that we put in place, and they examine the efficacy of these policies in different countries. All right, so the Bahamas had certain policies put in place. Jamaica had certain policies put in place. Trinidad had certain policies put in place, et cetera, et cetera. And we're examining them, all right? Policies put in place to deal with the shock of the pandemic, okay? So country summaries, Bahamas by Kamal Clayton. And who's this? Chloe Ortiz de Mendeville. Okay. Jamal Clayton and Chloe Ortiz de Mendeville. I'm not going to read all of it, because that would take us the rest of the show, really. But I'm going to go through some of it to help you... understand what they're saying. Now, I don't need to repeat for you what happened with the pandemic and talk about GDP growth, which was, you know, plummeted, all right, went in the reverse direction terribly several years ago. And now we've had some growth in 2021, pretty good growth, just under 14% projected. We won't know actuals until next year. We're looking at just under 14% predicted right now, and we're looking at about maybe 6% next year, although some say 8. But there are other things going on that I think look good for next year, the announcements that have been made. Now, announcements ain't money on the ground. It got to be, you know, like, so, for instance, the Carnival Cruise Port in Grand Bahama, that was announced years ago, stalled, and just got broken this year. All right? So, and I think that's stalled, yeah, over the course of the entire Minnis administration, pretty much. Yeah, over the course of the entire Minnis administration. So it just broke ground, and there's money on the ground. People are getting employed, X, Y, Z. So announcements are good, but that don't mean that the money's there, you know, that the money's going to happen. Let me see. This is BTC trying to scare everyone. Why I get a text about disconnection when the Y paid up should be a triggered alert. Yeah, agreed. So they need to transport Sam in one old rusty DC-8. You ever watch Con Air? Have I ever watched Con Air? How dare you insult me? So, have I watched Con Air? My lord. Who do you think you're speaking to? Have I watched Con Air with the legendary Nicolas Cage and John Malkovich? Of course I have. This says that, good afternoon, Juan. How much we have to pay to cancel Saxon's airtime? Nobody want to hear from them. Ah, Lord. It says, Juan, don't want to be off topic, but if road traffic is basically half day for the rest of the year, then why can't December licensees get extra days in January to pay our fees? Makes sense. What other month is disenfranchised like us? Good question. All right. Let's see here. Macroeconomic update. Says, great show as usual. One, could we give people who convicted of murder the same 150 years for murder? Well, I mean, now we just, you know, piling on if we're talking about 150 years for murder. Okay, let's get into it. It says the Bahamas is still recovering from the effects of the COVID-19 pandemic. Economy saw a contraction of 23.8%, real GDP in 2020, rebound of 13.7% in 2021. Despite additional global shocks in the last 6 months, economy is projected to grow by an additional 8% in 2022. Now, you say 8. You got that from the IMF. That's S&P. If I recall correctly, they revised down to 6.5. Pandemic brought the tourism-dependent economy to a standstill for almost 2 years. Tourism arrivals in the first 7 months of 2022 reached 81%. Those recorded in the first 6 months of 2019, thus suggesting a robust recovery. Removal in September 2022 of all pre-arrival testing, regardless of vaccination status, should further stimulate growth in time for winter travel season. And you can tell there's rebounding, right? Because I travel downtown a lot, and it's almost daily, really. Tourists are flocked downtown. And, you know, it's an embarrassment the way downtown looks, but the tourists are there. So there's money floating around if you can go get it. All right. Inflation and the broad global economic slowdown represents headwinds to the recovery in the Bahamas. Russian invasion of Ukraine is a shock that has reverberated globally, particularly in the commodities market. Like most small island developing states, and here's why this is important, the Bahamas is a net food and fuel importer and thus has acutely felt the impacts of sharp commodity price shocks. All right. In October 22, the IMF revised its April projections to suggest the end-of-year inflation rate will be 7.2%, an increase of 5 percentage points over the previous projection, and that overall real GDP will reach 94% instead of 96% of pre-pandemic figures. All right, fair enough. This says Bahamas was spared a large magnitude storm. Still, future hurricane season will continue to be a tangible risk to the country's recovery. All right. Despite these headwinds and risks, GDP is still projected to return its pre-pandemic levels. Now I'm going to see if I can get through this as cleanly as possible. To explain it to you. This says, for Bahamians, particularly the most vulnerable, the most pressing issue is likely the increasing cost of living as reflected by food inflation. About that, you would be correct. It's not likely the most pressing issue. It is the most pressing issue, the increasing cost of living. That, then I would say, all the wanton bloodshed would be the second most pressing issue. It says the Bahamas has a 1-to-1 currency peg that mitigates against inflation pass-through from exchange rate depreciation. Nonetheless, as of August 2022, Headline inflation was 6.4% year over year. Food and transport prices grew by 14.3% and 23.8%. Furthermore, Bahamas Power and Light announced in early October monthly fuel charge will increase 76% by August 2023 for those who consume less than 800 kilowatts per hour a month, 800 kilowatt hours per month, and 163% increase for those who consume more than 800 kilowatt hours per month. 160% increase. Good God. Taken together, these increases in food, transportation, and electricity prices will disproportionately impact the most vulnerable given the weight of such items in their consumption basket. To address high inflation, particularly for food, the Bahamas government has responded with a combination of temporary and permanent policies. These policies include an increase in the minimum wage for all workers, an increase in the value-added tax exemption threshold, import tariff exemptions, and the expansion of price controls for a list of key breadbasket items and medicines. Increase in minimum wage is the first since 2015 and is more targeted than other policies, so it'll benefit the lowest earning workers in the formal labor market. So let's talk about this real fast, and then we'll take a break. And then we'll get into whatever else they said. So they say that the minimum wage, okay, that's the most targeted policy that the government has done. Now, what do they mean by that? They mean that when you talk about reduce, and I'll explain to you why it makes no sense, but bottom line is this. The price controls aren't targeted because the rich and poor benefit from them, okay? The minimum wage, only those who make minimum wage will benefit because they're going to see an increase in salary, okay? Or make around minimum wage will benefit because they're going to see that increase, all right? So they targeted specifically minimum wage workers, all right? That's sound policy, all right? These broad policies, they don't have a great deal, they don't carry a great deal of relief for those who are most vulnerable, and we'll get into it. In fact, let's take that break, and then we'll talk about the price controls, et cetera, and what else is happening. Because, see, BPL, the government did price control earlier this year, okay, and it didn't work. It price controlled the fuel charge by subsidizing BPL, and ultimately it didn't work, and they have to now recoup all that money, and that's why your electricity bills are going up. We're going to take this break and be right back. Stay tuned.
Here we go. J.S. Johnson Insurance agents are the best. Reliable service. Protecting since 1919. J.S. Johnson Insurance has the best. Always, you're always calling me.
To think of the bank as my personal ATM machine. If I wanted a new car, new furniture, a weekend trip to Miami, no problem, just max out the credit card or top up my loan. I was a big baller until I realized that 75% of my salary was going to pay back all those loans. Fidelity's personal financial coaching was the best solution. Fidelity gave me a plan with a debt consolidation loan that has a built-in savings that pays 5% interest. I now only have one low monthly payment, plus money in my pocket. Give Fidelity Bank a call at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit any of Fidelity's locations or visit a website at fidelitygroup.com.
You do coffee your way.
Double shot, decaf, cappuccino.
Light roast, Colombian, no milk.
You do vacations your way.
Hiking boots, tent, mountains.
Five-star hotels and theater.
And now you can do insurance your way.
Online.
Email.
Chat.
WhatsApp.
Or in branch. For home, car, travel, boat, or business insurance, do it anyway with NUA Insurance agents and brokers. Visit NUAinsurance.com, call, or stop by a branch today.
Good afternoon, Bahamas. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. We're going through the price control stuff that IDB is talking about because I want you to understand that when people are going, you don't know what you're saying, and the grocers are just being greedy, and da-da-da-da. I want you to understand that there are people who apply study to this in a manner which the government does not appear to have studied this, all right? And therefore, I'm not just talking off the top of my head. The grocers aren't, and the pharmacists aren't just talking off the top of their heads. You could study this and look at it and see, would this work? Would this make sense from a policy perspective? All right? And to me, it doesn't. All right? It says, I don't want to hear from Saxons either, not because I don't like them. I love them, but exactly what can they say that's new? World-famous Saxon superstars. We could be ready. We could win. We got the best music. Everybody going to be dazzling. Greatest show on earth. Boring. They're going to say that, but they said they wanted to come to talk about some stuff they're doing this year that they haven't done previously. And, you know, it's been a couple of years since Junkanoo, since we've had Junkanoo. So, really, we're interested in hearing what they got to say. All right. So, let's look at it. Price controls. IDB says price controls, which were updated after consultation with the affected stakeholders, cap the markup of several medications and 38 bread basket items at wholesalers and retailers for affected consultation. Is that what happened? The consultation happened? Yeah? The pharmacy didn't shut down? Okay. All right. It says, for effective medications, markups are capped at 20% for wholesalers and 40% for retailers. Bread basket items are capped at 15% for wholesalers. Additionally, to account for differences in economics due to geography, retailers in New Providence and Grand Bahama capped at 25% and 30%, respectively, for dry goods and perishables, while retailers in the remaining family islands will receive an additional 5% markup for both categories. Perishables, as their name suggests, have a limited shelf life and thus cannot be stored for long periods. Therefore, sold perishables must also cover the cost of unsold produce, in addition to other operating costs, such as refrigeration and labor. Let's wind that back and come again. Perishables, like apples, oranges, grapes, watermelons, they perish and cannot be stored for long periods of time. So, for instance, you're going to buy your case of strawberries. It's already, the clock's already ticking from Florida. It comes by the boat, so that's going to take, a day to come from Florida? Someone tell me I'm not in shipping. That's gonna take some time to come from Florida. Then it's got to go customs, and they take it to the warehouse. From the warehouse, they take it to the store. I believe that's how it all works. So I'm not a grocer. That's how the supply chain works, I believe. So it's been a couple of days, and then it goes on the shelf, right? And so you get the shelf, and you get your shiny strawberries, right? But the clock's been ticking, and you come back 2 days later, some of the strawberries may have some mold on them, right? So you're not going to buy moldy strawberries unless you're something's off with you. And the store can't sell the strawberries. So the percentage of the shipment that was sold not only goes to cover the cost of the strawberries that were sold, but the cost of the strawberries that were purchased that were not sold. Also, the percentage of the produce that was sold, and I don't know where the profit centers are, but let's just say produce is one of them. The money has to still cover the portion of shipping and electricity and et cetera that went into purchasing those strawberries. All right? So the what you sell has to cover the price of what was sold and what was unsold and labor and the higher electricity cost. All right? And what the IDB doesn't say is that because of inflation, revenues are going to be higher and business license fees are calculated on gross turnover beyond $100,000, I believe. So the business license is going to be more expensive. So the government's going to have to take that into account because a lot of business is going to go, man, I can't do it. And the government wants its money. All right? Somebody's got to pay to dig up Village Road. So, all right? It says at least 17 goods out of the 38 can be categorized as perishable. For a few items, the estimated spoilage rates are high enough that the required markup is approximately the same as the maximum markup allowed in the original proposal, all right? I.e. 25%. So you're going to lose a quarter of your shipment for some for a lot of these items, all right? Just from spoilage. It adds that these figures are based on U.S. supermarket chains, which likely have more reliable coal storage supply chains, and thus may underestimate figures for their Bahamian counterparts. So he's saying U.S. spoilage rate for some of these items, 25%. Ours could be higher, right? I don't know. Someone who's in grocery, let me know what your spoilage rates are for the produce. It goes on to say, it's occasional load shedding, especially during tropical storms, is an added risk that increases spoilage rates for Bahamian grocers and supermarkets. All right. It says, under the original proposal, where other operating costs are included, it's possible that several items may become unprofitable. Listen to this. Especially for small and medium enterprises operating in the Family Islands, where transportation and refrigerating costs are higher. All right. This says, a price control, at least in terms of behavior, if adequately enforced, is a de facto combined turnover tax, all right? So they're going to tell you that no, price control is not a turnover tax, but where revenue is turned over to the customer. But if you enforce it, it's going to become a turnover tax, whether you want to call it that or not, all right? So price control is essentially you're taking money from the business to benefit the customer, all right? Revenues for specific products that would have accrued to specific businesses and possibly to the government in the form of increased VAT would now be transferred to all Bahamians. So listen to what they're saying. All right. Well, let me finish. It says, additionally, despite the updates, the price controls do not differentiate using size or profitability. Therefore, this policy is likely to impact small and medium-sized enterprises negatively and disproportionately because they're more likely to have neither the volume of sales nor the economies of scale to absorb the per-unit loss of revenue. In addition, they will have to use these same diminished margins to cover increasing electricity bills and labor costs. Furthermore, like price controls, the VAT exemption for electricity bills would result in government revenue transferred to Bahamians, including those who are least affected by inflation. Hence, except for the minimum wage, the remaining policies outlined are effectively untargeted subsidies for everyone, both the rich and poor. That said, as a short-term temporary measure, the price controls have the advantage of not imposing any direct expenditure costs on budget. All right, let's break it down for 2 minutes, and then we got to take a break. Okay? They're saying that what you're doing is taking money from the businesses to benefit the customer. Okay? The government didn't want to target people directly and give them extra cash to pay for the rising cost of inflation and get some of that money back in the form of VAT. They made the businesses pay, in effect. All right, a turnover tax is like your business license. You're taxed on goods turning over. They're saying this is like a turnover tax. All right, so you're impacting businesses. And not only are you impacting businesses, you're impacting small and medium-sized enterprises more because they don't really have the volume to take the hit. All right? On top of that, they're saying that you really shouldn't have done it this way because the people who can afford it now are benefiting as well. So I can afford the extra. I can afford the $17 lettuce, although I'm not buying it, but I can afford it. So I'm going to take advantage of it if you cut the price, but I could afford it. So you're not only is the government doing me a solid, I keep more money in my pocket, which I like, but the business is having to fork over its profit. But also, you're stopping me from paying money back to the Treasury. So you're losing money. You're giving me a tax break and a price break in effect. Right? And I could afford it. But you weren't trying to help me. You were trying to help the least vulnerable because inflation just is what it is. It sucks, but you got to just pay it because we don't produce goods here in any significant measure to avoid it. All right? So let's take a break and we'll be back on the other side.
How important collecting your money can be to the success of your business. Start your relationship with Fidelity today so that we can show you the many options available to you with our merchant services, from click and pay options online to merchant terminals and e-commerce options. We're here to help your business succeed. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
This Yuletide season, start a new Christmas tradition by joining Bahamas Faith Ministries by donating toys, gifts, and school supplies for the Hope for the Holidays Christmas promotion. Hope for the Holidays brings joy and happiness to the faces of children without at least one parent because they're serving time in prison. This Christmas, give hope for the holidays and let the children of incarcerated parents experience a real Christmas. They open presents, eat a meal, and spend time making new Christmas memories. Hope for the Holidays gives incarcerated parents the opportunity to have their kids blessed with gifts and lifelong memories, giving them a newfound joy and motivation to make the necessary changes in their lives to be a positive and supportive role model for their kids. Toys, gifts, and funds for Hope for the Holidays can be donated at the Miles E. Monroe Diplomat Center. Hope for the Holidays Christmas promotion, proudly sponsored by Guardian Media.
Let's celebrate Christmas with huge discounts and a brand new 55-inch Samsung TV. To enter to win, just make a purchase of $40 from December 10th through the 24th. It's that simple. Come and save big at our three huge tent sales on December 10th, 17th, and 23rd. Stocking stuffers are 50% off. Christmas decorations, 25% off. cosmetics at 50 cents and a dollar, jewelry also at 50 cents and a dollar, and 50% off gifts and baby clothing. Plus, bring the kids to see Santa from 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. We're located on Mackey Street opposite Carrie's Fabric Store from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. for your chance to win. Happy holidays from Girls Will Be Girls and Discounts Galore.
Muhammad, welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney. So good to have you with us. I don't see the Saxons people yet, but maybe they're still coming. I don't know. Maybe they got caught up in the shack. I don't know. They're battling. We were talking about price control. This says... Juan, where can you go to check food quality? I bought some produce with a very heavy chemical odor, but no taste. I know that's a property of cyanide, but since I still kick and I assume it's not that. I want someone who knows what they're talking about to tell me what this is. Sure, it could be something they always spray, but I'd like to confirm. Well, let me tell you what I do, buddy. Because I don't know what the food been through and who been breeding up on it and where it been sitting in XYZ. So if it ain't in a package that I could open to make sure it ain't been exposed to... XYZ, you bring your produce home, even bananas I do this with, you bring your produce home, and you take a bowl, and you take it out of the package, and you put, fill the bowl with a few cups of water, and then you put some baking soda in the water, and just let it sit for just a minute, and you'll see all, and just, then you just... You'll see all the dirt start to rise to the surface, and then just put your hand in there and kind of gently roll the produce around, and you'll get the dirt off, and then rinse it real good. And then you dry it good, because if you leave it wet, it's going to get moldy fast. Dry it real good, and put it in containers and put it in your refrigerator. That's what I do. Now, you may not want to go through all that, but you are consuming quite a bit of dirt, quite a bit of dirt. All right, let's get back to this IDP. Okay, so basically the IDP is saying that the Bahamas didn't really effectively target the most vulnerable because they've done things that benefit the rich and the poor in terms of purchasing the goods at the store. And they've also done things that have put small and medium-sized enterprises at a disadvantage compared to the big guys. And, you know, the economy runs on small, medium-sized businesses. You know what I mean? Like, that's the economy functions on that. You know, I mean, the hotels and stuff are nice, but, you know, they don't account for all the other businesses that are out there providing services and goods, you know? So you want to make sure to protect them, to keep them healthy, all right? So let's talk about alternative policy options that the IDP suggests. So the IDP says, we'll talk about some other stuff too. The IDP says... Unlike price controls, which are blunt policy tools, a more targeted response, such as a conditional or unconditional cash transfer, could build on existing programs, such as emergency food assistance, that provides food stamps to qualifying families. All right. Beneficiaries, and the And in fact, the grocers, the Retail Grocers Association, suggested that they increase the value of the food stamps, for lack of a better term, the government vouchers, that they increase the value they'd honor them at the store. I think it was 10%. They said they'd increase 10%. They'd honor over 10% of the value actually on the voucher. Okay? And listen to me carefully. If you out there and you need assistance with food, then you go get your food assistance. All right? Don't let pride hold you back. You go get your food assistance and you go and you use your food vouchers until you can do better. Or if you're like, say, on a fixed income, a pensioner or whatever like this, and you need those food, you go get your food stamps. You hear? Go get your food stamps. Don't be shy about it, and don't be shy to go ahead and use it, all right? But they say that they should have put a conditional or unconditional cash transfer. So a conditional cash transfer would be where you have to meet certain criteria. An unconditional cash transfer is where you just go get the cash because you need it, right? So, for instance, the feeding program, you just had to sign up. They want no proof that you weren't working. They don't ask you to talk about your household income, from what I recall. They just wanted you to sign up. If you need the food, sign up. We'll give you the food. That's it. All right? In America, they did unconditional cash transfers by just cutting checks, which I don't believe was a great idea. But they did. Says, beneficiaries of this policy would be Bahamians who earn less than a predefined income threshold, low enough to ensure that only the most vulnerable qualify, but high enough that it does not distort incentives for those earning close to minimum wage. Beyond targeting food insecurity, well-designed and innovative cash transfers could have other beneficial secondary effects. For example, instead of food stamps, the government could transfer sand dollars to restricted digital wallets, which would have the secondary effect of increasing the use of digital currency and fostering financial inclusion for the unbanked and underbanked. Let's go back through that. Beyond targeting, so they say, beneficiaries of the policy would be Bahamians who earn less than a predefined income threshold, all right? Low enough to ensure only the most vulnerable qualify, but high enough that it doesn't distort incentives for those earning close to the minimum wage. You see? Now, it says, beyond targeting food insecurity, well-designed and innovative cash transfers could have other beneficial secondary effects. For example, instead of food stamps, government could transfer sand dollars to restricted digital wallets. Okay, sand dollars, restricted digital wallets. Let's slow on down. All right? Sand dollars, of course, are digital Bahamian dollars. It's not crypto. It's digital money. Okay? It's Bahamian fiat currency. Okay? That's what sand dollars are. So they're saying the government can give you sand dollars to a restricted digital wallet. So you get your digital wallet, you get your sand dollars, but you can't go buy rum with it. All right? It's restricted to certain purchases, and that's easy to do. All right? Digital wallet is any of these things, which is Canoe and what? There's some other ones. Sun something? Sun? There's a Sun one. And there's, I don't know. So they say that doing that would have the secondary effect of increasing the use of digital currency and fostering financial inclusion for the unbanked and underbanked. And I think sand dollars are a good idea. A lot of people, they knock it because let's just do cash, man. What are we doing? But we're going to have to get to a point where we can pay people without cash and checks. You know, it doesn't make sense. So for me, if you want to do business with me, like just on a personal level, like you want to, I need you to be my electrician or whatever. You don't want to do some electrician work for me. I got to be able to wire you money, man. I'm not going to no ATM to go get money to go. I ain't going through all that. All right. Anything but that, like, you know, you want to do some work for me, XYZ, I'm a wire you the money, right? You'd landscape and I'm wiring the money. I ain't keeping cash on me or going hitting up ATMs, XYZ all the time. Now, some things you can only do cash because everyone ain't set up like that, but we got to get to a place where we are, right? So let's say you braiding hair, right? We got to get to a place where you're able to use the Apple Pay with the U.S. Customers, right? Like they do at the big hotels. Now, like, we got to get to that point. You know what I mean? You're selling T-shirts, you're renting scooters or whatever like that. Everybody ain't carrying hundreds of dollars of cash around on them because the cruise ship people done telling them, don't take no bunch of money downtown because it's crime and all this X, Y, Z. All right? So we got to get to that point so that we can broaden economic inclusion. You know what I'm saying? We got to. Like, we got to... Anyway, let me not use that example. So this says, the economic literature has broadly shown that well-designed and targeted conditional cash transfers can have positive and statistically significant effects as seen in Jamaica's program of advancement through health and education and Brazil's Bolsa Família. Furthermore, in July 2022, in line with a broad economic consensus, the IMF, World Bank, Food and Agricultural Organization, World Trade Organization, and World Food Program argued in a joint statement that cash transfers to the most vulnerable are more effective, both in cost and impact, than untargeted food and energy subsidies. You remember I read that for you? Remember I said it just wasn't me? Where's the guy who tells, oh, it's time I have to bring an expert on. I don't know how the economy works and all that stuff like that. It's because I don't know nothing. So remember I told you? So in line with a broad economic consensus, who are we talking about? The IMF, the World Bank, the World Trade Organization, the Food and Agricultural Organization, and the World Food Program all said that. Because who we owe money? The IDB is saying it. We owe them money. The IMF is saying it. We owe the IMF money because of the pandemic. The World Bank is saying it. We owe the World Bank money because of the pandemic. We're not part of the World Trade Organization because I don't understand why we're not. Every other country in CARICOM is in the World Trade Organization, but whatever. And the World Food Program said cash transfers to the most vulnerable are more effective, both in cost and impact, than untargeted food and energy subsidies, okay? So another subsidy is the VAT extent. Let me air my grievances, like Festivus. So I said this before, I'm going to say it again, because they did it again. Let me go through this. To explain to you that this isn't making sense, okay? To me. Okay, so I'm looking at my BPL bill, yeah? And let me just make sure I'm not freaking out. Okay, yes, I'm looking at my BPL bill. They say it's up 20.8% from last year. Those are lies, BPL. You're not checking my meter. You're not. I know you're not. You're guessing. Don't tell me your pseudoscience about you sit off in the park and you can just see all the meters buzz the numbers to you. I did not use 20% more electricity than last December. That's not true. I know it's not true. But anyway, looking at my BPL bill, and according to the government, now somebody said, I need to look at the actual change to the regulation. But according to the government, if you use under $400 electricity, you get a VAT exemption, okay? Why then? I used well over 800 kilowatt hours per, I'm sorry, if you use over 800 kilowatt hours per month, you get the you get a VAT exemption up to $400, period. Not 800 kilowatt hours. You just get a VAT exemption up to $400. That's what I understood, right? Or are we playing mind word games where they're saying, well, if your bill is under $400, you get the VAT exemption. Why? Why would you do that? But as far as I'm aware, it should be $400 is not taxed, but you're still taxing me on the 400. Here's the thing, though. You're taxing me on the entire thing. So I should not be taxed. I should be taxed on the portion over $400. That's what I should be taxed on. But you're taxing me on the entire portion of it. That's a problem. I don't think you should be doing that. See, I pay my bill down to zero. All right? I can't ask, give me headaches to go and... Oh, what this pod past doing this? I don't know. Because I used to do that when I first got married, and it was a problem. And I forgot about a month, and I had something else, and it was over 500. And they come cut my light off. And you don't want to be, I've learned, a married man living in a house with a woman who has no electricity. That's not something you want. It's going to be a problem. But you guys have charged me on the entire portion, on the entire bill, and have not given me my exemption of my $400 BPL. You owe me some money, Governor of the Bahamas. I want money back. Here's the issue, though. If my bill were under $400, which I could do if I decided to do hand wash all the clothes or whatever like that, if my bill were under $400, you would get no VAT from me, but I can afford to pay it. You're benefiting. I'm middle income. You're benefiting, all right? The people who could, you're giving a tax break to the people who could afford to pay this, and the broke people. You see? So you're not making sense. You're robbing yourself of money that you could be getting from people who could afford to pay. Makes no sense. But that's what's happening with BPL. So again, the IDB says, you're not reading my meter. Don't lie to me. I don't like it. Okay. The untargeted food and energy subsidies are not as effective as cash transfers. All right? Just give people cash. All right? You're going to recoup some of it in VAT anyway. Just give the people cash. I'm just playing. I know BPL's fine. Yeah, read the meter. Maybe I'm using 20% more. This says, increasing financing costs, also a growing fiscal liability. Okay? Now, we need to talk about this, but we need to talk about it in a structured manner, this little piece right here, and then we can get to the conclusion. So let's take a break, and then we'll get back to this.
This Yuletide season, start a new Christmas tradition by joining Bahamas Faith Ministries by donating toys, gifts, and school supplies for the Hope for the Holidays Christmas promotion. Hope for the Holidays brings joy and happiness to the faces of children without at least one parent because they're serving time in prison. This Christmas, give Hope for the Holidays and let the children of incarcerated parents experience a real Christmas. They open presents, eat a meal, and spend time making new Christmas memories. Hope for the Holidays gives incarcerated parents the opportunity to have their kids blessed with gifts and lifelong memories, giving them a newfound joy and motivation to make the necessary changes in their lives to be a positive and supportive role model for their kids. Toys, gifts, and funds for Hope for the Holidays can be donated at the Miles E. Monroe Diplomat Center. Hope for the Holidays Christmas promotion, proudly sponsored by Guardian Media.
Popeyes. We may not have started the chicken wars, but now we come in peace. Pieces, that is. 8 pieces, 12 pieces, 24, 36, and 48 pieces. Introducing our all-new, all-white meat, perfectly seasoned chicken nuggets. Enjoy 8 pieces of our crispy, juicy chicken nuggets. A side of your choice, a biscuit, and a regular-sized beverage for just $8, VAT inclusive. Experience the joy of life with an abundant amount of peace.
Love that chicken from Popeyes.
You do coffee your way.
Double shot, decaf, cappuccino.
Light roast, Colombian, no milk.
You do vacations your way.
Hiking boots, tent, mountains.
Five-star hotels and theater.
And now you can do insurance your way.
Online.
Email.
Chat.
WhatsApp.
Or in branch. For home, car, travel, boat, or business insurance, do it anyway with NUA Insurance agents and brokers. Visit NUAinsurance.com, call, or stop by a branch today.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
Let's celebrate Christmas with huge discounts and a brand new 55-inch Samsung TV. To enter to win, just make a purchase of $40 from December 10th through the 24th. It's that simple. Come and save big at our three huge tent sales on December 10th, 17th, and 23rd. Stocking stuffers are 50% off. Christmas decorations, 25% off. Cosmetics at 50 cents and a dollar. Jewelry also at 50 cents and a dollar. And 50% off gifts and baby clothing. Plus, bring the kids to see Santa from 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. We're located on Mackey Street opposite Carrie's Fabric Store from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. for your chance to win. Happy holidays from Girls Will Be Girls and discounts galore.
Rejuvenate. Refresh. Treat yourself. Immerse yourself in total comfort. Pamper yourself. After all, you're worth it. Relax. Rid yourself of all life's stresses. At Baja Retreat Anti-Aging Spa, you will find everything you need to enhance your body and spirit. Call today at 323-6711 and begin your journey to serenity at Baja Retreat Anti-Aging Spa.
Good afternoon, Bahamas. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney. So good to have you with us. This says, gotta call BPL's bluff and take phone pics of that meter every other day or just multiple times around the 8th or 10th when they read the meter. Yeah, I don't know what's going on. I don't know. I don't remember December of 2021 with a great deal, or November of 2021 with a great deal of clarity, but I'm fairly certain I did not use more. I can't imagine why it would be saying I'm using 20% more electricity. Wait. Hmm. actually BPL. I apologize. You may be correct. I'm not going to get into it on air, but you may be correct. Well, it's my math lab, and so I think that I'm kidding. I am joking. That was a poor joke. I do apologize. I do not have a meth lab. I do not endorse anyone doing methamphetamines, particularly creating them. This says, hi, Juan, the best journalist. Wishing you and your little family a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year with good health and long life. Why, thank you. I appreciate that very much. It says, hey, Juan, there are some differences between Bahamas and Jamaica, etc. Are e-perishables that can defend the government's position. Firstly, there's a wider public interest in encouraging the consumption of more fruits and vegetables, irrespective of income levels. The rich and poor need to be healthier. I'm finished reading this, then I'm going to respond. The rich and poor need to be healthier, all right? But there's a need to ensure a basic level of uptake of green perishables to ensure the supply for everyone. I am out of that. In Jamaica and South America, their poor people would only consume grounds on what can be taken freely from the earth. There's a recognition that the majority of our poor cannot survive that way, as the free food supply of basics is virtually non-existent. Now, that's fine, right? That's fine. I don't agree that supports the government, that makes sense of the government's policy. But I'll say this, and here's the problem, right? In Jamaica, they have a lot of rural arable land, right? So you got, like, the city, like Kingston, right? And then you have, like, all these wide areas. They have mountains, etc. They could grow coffee in Jamaica. They grow all sorts of great things. Jamaica's position to where, if you want to go to, like, I don't know if y'all ever lived in an area where they have, like, farmers markets. Like, we have that here, but it ain't a consistent thing. If you want to go, you could go to the market every day in Jamaica and buy your food, right? So they farm. They have livestock in Jamaica, too, in a way that we don't, right? So Jamaica was sending cash transfers to people for just living, all right? I read a bit about the program, but I'm not well-versed enough in it to explain off the top of my head. But we're different in terms of Jamaica. Now, you're saying you want to get poor people and rich people to eat well. That's fine. It's just what we need to do. That approach doesn't make sense to me because it's a blunt instrument, and it just whack, price control. Now they can afford fruits and vegetables. That doesn't make sense to me because, A, they still can't afford fruit and vegetables because the lettuce is still $17. And, B, it's much more effective to start community gardens, to promote farming on, let's say, Abaco, Grand Bahama. They have a great deal of arable land, and we can have goods here the next day from them. It makes much more sense to go that route. Andros, all right, is right there, right? And Bamsey's doing something. It makes more sense to promote more farming, more growing goods here so that we have things that we can survive off of. All right? And I think if you grew those things there and they were very affordable, we would do more of that. All right? It says, I don't think sand dollar in and of itself is bad. The way they went about trying to force people to adopt it by creating monopoly was wrongheaded. Monopoly? And what do you mean monopoly and sand dollar? What do you mean? There could only be one Bahamian digital currency. Well, there is only one. I don't. John Roll might be cooking up something else. Who knows? Says the food stores add a percentage in their pricing to cover perishable items / spoilage, so they never lose or shouldn't. The food stores add a percentage in their pricing to cover perishable items / spoilage, so they never lose or shouldn't. Right, right. Okay, so listen to what you're saying. You're saying the food stores add a percentage in their pricing to cover perishable items / spoilage, so they never lose or shouldn't. That percentage that they added in, the government made them cut. And they're legally barred from doing it without the permission of the minister, from adding it in. So if the food stores might say, well, that's exactly right. That's where that was a nice little profit center for us, right? Green apples. And we had a little tucked away in there, one little 7% that we could pocket. And now the government say you can't do it. And that's why they're saying we are losing because you're taking that out. Says Walter White, hello. Says, my most recent bill from BPL is way over 20% up on last month. Wife and I have been racking our brains to what caused the increase. It's been cooler too, and there's no additional usage we can think of. Yeah, I don't know. It's weird. Like, my usage isn't 20% more than the previous month. My usage is 20% more than the same month the previous year. And now that I think about it, there is something that may account for that. Maybe. Now that I think about it. Okay. It says, absolutely, we need to have more community gardens, et cetera, and respect and promotion of that has to start with the schools and their food gardens. Yeah, exactly. Like, you know, at every school should have a garden. I don't even know, and a greenhouse. I don't even know if Queens College has one, to be honest. But there's, like, AF Adderley has, like, a huge garden, and they have, like, chickens and XYZ, you know? And I think every government school should have it, because every government school is on huge parcels of land. You dig? So everyone should have it. Because I'm going to get into some backyard farming here in a minute. All right, let's talk about this part of it here. This says, increasing financing costs, a growing fiscal liability. All right, let's get into it. All right. This says, relying on the capital markets to finance a deficit or any additional social support programs has grown more costly, with Moody's downgrading its unsecured sovereign debt to B1, the second such downgrade in 13 months. Additionally, the United States, which has already raised rates 5 times in the last 6 months, and other developed markets will see incremental increases in their policy rates, as discussed in the regional chapter of this report. With the likelihood of a global recession increasing, appetite for emerging market assets will decrease, and the cost of financing debt will also increase as investors favor safe assets such as U.S. Treasury bonds. We're going to go back through it, don't worry. This development is particularly concerning as reconstruction costs following any severe tropical storm will likely be funded using progressively scarce and expensive debt. Moreover, the Bahamian government's financing needs remain elevated, and in the medium term, external debt service will rise given already acquired commitments. Fiscal space for the Bahamas will continue to be constrained in the short to medium term. All right, that's pretty clear to me to understand, but let me explain it to you. All right. Relying on capital markets to finance a deficit quickly. All right. Their budget has two categories, revenue expenditure. All right. If you spend more money than you take in, if you budget to spend more money than you're actually budgeting to take in or taking in, you are in a deficit, which means that your budget is not fully funded. Therefore, you're going to have to borrow to fund it, that or raise taxes or sell some stuff. When you do deficit spending, you're spending borrowed money, okay? Relying on capital markets to find that money you want to borrow is going to be a problem okay? Capital markets like U.S., right? It's going to be a problem because Moody's has rated us as more non-investment grade. So we're more junk? Double junk? So people are wary of lending the Bahamas money unless we're attaching high, they're attaching high interest rates to it. All right? So it's more costly. You get downgraded by the credit agencies, it gets more costly. All right? These people aren't your friends. They're trying to make money for their investors. All right? Additionally, the United States, well, let me say this. So they're talking about getting more costly. We're paying more than $500 million is just to service our debt. Just to service it. That's it. $500 million. All right? So it's a problem, if you understand what I'm saying. That's what, 12 or 13% of the budget, maybe? The budget's $3 billion. Is that 15%? Anyway. So, and it's getting more costly to do it. Now, we've projected we could be done with deficit spending by 2030. I don't buy it, but we'll see. So, additionally, United States has raised interest rates 5 times, all right? In other developed markets, we'll see incremental increases 5 times in the last 6 months. In their policy rates. They're trying to slow down the economy, is what the Fed is doing. with the likelihood of a global recession increasing, appetite for emerging market assets will decrease, okay? So the U.S. Is likely going to have a recession. The Biden administration is saying that it's not going to be a true recession because the job market is still strong, but inflation is wild stuff. All right. Appetite for emerging market assets. So what are emerging markets? Emerging markets are markets like ours, right? So we're not developed markets. We don't have like commodities and all this other stuff like that. Well, you know, aragonite. But we're emerging markets, and the appetite for me to buy an asset from an emerging market, if I'm an investment firm, is going to be less likely if I'm looking at a recession, because I want to park my assets in U.S. Treasury bonds, all right? It says the development's concerning, particularly as reconstruction costs following any severe tropical storm will likely be funded using debt, all right? So we have to go rebuild Grand Bahama's airport. That's debt. All right, we're going to use money, we're going to use debt for that. All right, same with Long Island, same with Abaco, same with Exuma. Or is Exuma, well, it's either way we're going to borrow, because it's, even if it's funded in the budget now. Right. Moreover, the Bahamian government's financing needs remain elevated. In the medium term, external debt service will rise, given already acquired commitments. Fiscal space for the Bahamas will continue to be constrained in the short to medium term. So it's a problem, all right? It's a problem that we have, okay? Conclusion. Now we'll take a break. We'll read some text. We'll be right back. So they talked about, so because this report is about emerging from the pandemic, and they're saying that the most vulnerable are still in problems. The government policy choices are not as targeted as they need to be. You're targeting the people who can afford to pay, and you're starving yourself of revenue. The policy is too broad. All right. On top of that, you're trying to emerge from the pandemic as we have all this inflation, everything going on. It's still impacting people. Energy costs are going wild. And you now have an issue where you don't have the fiscal headroom in the budget to move like you want move because you're spending so much money servicing your debt. Now, we ain't got to have no debt. You know what I mean? You could bring me that budget. now, and I'll balance it for you. I'll put you in a surplus right now, before in the next 15 minutes before the end of the show. I'll put you in a budgetary surplus. It ain't no problem. You just ain't gonna have certain things. Is all. You just not. Right. So if you want stuff, we could go right now. Because we hear all this talk. Well, you're traveling, you're spending all the money, what was it, 14 million that they allocated? That ain't gonna balance no budget. Now, 14 million could help a lot of people. I'm not saying it ain't, it's chicken feed. I'm just saying, you know, it could help, it ain't gonna fix the budget if they stop flying. Conclusion. The Bahamas is expected to have a robust economic recovery as tourism activity progressively returns to pre-pandemic levels. However, broad macroeconomic challenges, driven primarily by external shocks, will continue to present risks in the short to medium term. Okay? Broad macroeconomic, so macroeconomic challenges are huge factors of the economy, driven by external shocks, so hurricanes, et cetera, like that. You know what I mean? The government faces an unenviable balancing act to ensure that its pursuit of food security does not jeopardize its need for fiscal discipline. The government's tight fiscal space, both high debt and persistent fiscal deficits, will constrain its policy options and thus underscore the need for targeted and consensus-driven responses to mitigate the inflationary impact, particularly for the most vulnerable. Now, they don't want to say the elephant in the room, right? Which is you balancing on a tightrope right now and right around the corner as a structured IMF program. With a structured IMF program, you ain't gonna see the level of deficit spending that we engaged in, period. We have a very, very precarious situation. It's not impossible. It is challenging without doubt. We have, I believe, almost $12 billion in debt. Almost half of that debt is in foreign currency. There are massive foreign currency balloon payments coming due in the coming years. And we are taking on more debt because we're engaged in deficit spending. We're funding the deficits by taking on more debt. We're spending highly to service the debt, and we have huge debt balloon payments coming due. Can we pull it off? I hope so. I think there are enough smart people around to do it. But it is unenviable, as the IDB notes. All right, let's do a couple of these. Do we have to take a break, or are we good? We do? Let's take a break. We'll be right back.
The holidays are a time for reflection on the year past, reconnecting with family and friends, and indulging in brand new experiences. No matter what your holiday may bring, at Rev, we want to remind you to do it together. Play together. Watch together. Be together. Take time this Christmas to connect with the people and things that really matter. And let Rev take care of home for the holidays. Merry Christmas, Bahamas!
Fidelity, we're good for you.
I used to think of the bank as my personal ATM machine. If I wanted a new car, new furniture, a weekend trip to Miami, no problem, just max out the credit card or top up my loan. I was a big baller.
until I realized that 75% of my salary was going to pay back all those loans. Fidelity's personal financial coaching was the best solution. Fidelity gave me a plan with a debt consolidation loan that has a built-in savings that pays 5% interest. I now only have one low monthly payment, plus money in my pocket. Give Fidelity Bank a call at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit any of Fidelity's locations or visit a website at fidelitygroup.com.
Rejuvenate, refresh, treat yourself. Immerse yourself in total comfort. Pamper yourself. After all, you're worth it. Relax. Rid yourself of all life stresses. At Baja Retreat Anti-Aging Spa, you will find everything you need to enhance your body and spirit. Call today at 323-6711 and begin your journey to serenity at Baja Retreat Anti-Aging Spa.
At Ron's Electric Motors, they repair and rewind all major brands of electric motors, including water pumps, generators, and the generator's back end, welding machines, electric lifts, air compressors, battery chargers, and more. They're equipped to handle up to 850 kilowatts and rewind up to 450 horsepower motors. They're conveniently located on the corner of Wolf and Clarence Roads and are open weekdays 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., Saturdays till noon. They offer 24 hours emergency assistance. You can reach them 242-356-0249.
Burger King wants you to ride into the holidays in style with a brand new 2022 BYD Han all-electric sedan from Easy Car Sales. It's as easy as 1, 2, 3. Just upgrade your favorite combo for one ticket or double your chances with the King Combo or triple your chance to win with the purchase of a BK family deal. It's electric at Burger King this holiday where you get the chance to win a 2022 BYD Han EV sedan when you upgrade your combo at Burger King Nassau, where taste is king.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the revolution here on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney. Good to have you with us. So we're talking about the IDV. It's important that you guys know this stuff so that you can understand people who are taking a kind of a research-driven approach to it, who are collating data, and who are comparing it to what has happened in other countries in the region, and comparing the regional position, okay? It says D.W. Davis also has a great farm, Juan. Ducks, chickens, goats, veggies, introduced under former principal Abe Stubbs. Great, I did not know that. That's awesome. That's Candia's alma mater. No, I lie, H.O. Nash is her alma mater. It says, yes, one digital currency, but multiple cashless payment options. Okay. They appeared to have a preference for one of the payment providers, then sought to prevent anyone else from entering the industry. They were then barreling down the road to check elimination. If the food festival hadn't had so many problems, they would have continued on that ill-advised route. People should adopt because they see it helps them, not because they're forced to. That's innovation. You make a tangible point. Yeah, you make a salient point. Now, I went to Jollification, and I didn't have any problems using Sand Dollar, but I've been using Sand Dollar since they... since shortly after it came out. If the governor's central bank tell me it's money, then it's real money to me. I don't need to seek deeper answers than that. If the man who signature on the paper money say the sand dollar is actual money, I'ma go with it. All right. So I don't know why people have a problem with it. I won. The government revenue structure is dependent on that huge food import bill. That's why they'll never take large farming serious. This is why we need income tax. It's simply more equitable. Well, my do. You had a... Let me repeat that for you. This person got their thinking cap on. Right? But I can show you something. I can show you something right now. Hold on. It says, hi, Juan. The government revenue structure is dependent on that huge food import bill. That is why they'll never take large-scale farming serious. This is why we need income tax. It's simply more equitable. Listen to me. If we collect hundreds of millions of dollars of revenue on importing food, right? Food, fuel, those are the big ones, all right? Yeah, cars, merchandise, etc. But food and fuel, we cannot live without. I mean, we could go caveman and I'll hit the sea. He says that's why the structure needs to change. Listen to what the IDB said, okay? The IDB said the government's tight fiscal space, high debt and fiscal deficits, will constrain its policy. No, that's not the part I want to talk about. Here's what it says. The government faces an unenviable balancing act to ensure that its pursuit of food security does not jeopardize its need for fiscal discipline. All right? There's the balancing act. Pursuing food security without being indisciplined fiscally. Now, I ain't got the plan. Somebody else might have the plan. I don't have the answers, okay? But I think this is a she. Oh, this is a she. I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to not rate you like that. It's a she, not a he. And she makes a great point. Am I a sexist, do you think? I just assume? It's a man. I apologize. I did not mean to do that. So we got to put our thinking caps on. If we're going to reduce our food imports, right? Because the government keeps saying we're going to reduce food imports. They're part of the CARICOM, I think it's 25 by 25 initiative to reduce food imports by 25%. All right. What does that do? Do we then increase value-added tax to make up that fiscal space? What do? We have great needs and great challenges as a nation. All right, what do we do? It's a very big challenge. Yeah, so we're trying to reduce our regional food bill by 25% by 2025. I don't think we're going to do it. It says, yes, you are. I didn't mean to be. Says Food Fest was a good example about how the infrastructure needs to be improved. It was quicker to pay cash during Food Fest because the handheld machines vendors had took a long time to process payments due to slow internet. Okay. Digital transformation can't be done in a silo. The slow processing machine ate away at the convenience of the sand dollar and canoe pay offered. Okay, gotcha. One, the fundamental problem with digital currency is... that it can only be used for pre-approved purchases versus the money in our pocket being in our discretion. Big difference. What do you mean? You could buy whatever you want with it. Whoever takes the money, you could do it. Well, the Biden administration said inflation was going to be transitory. No one with a business degree believed that with his war on domestic oil and gas. Now they're saying 2023 won't see a real recession. We're supposed to believe them. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know if I buy that either. It says all talk show hosts are sexist. It's like, kid... But it's almost natural to think only men can think deeply. I don't think that, and I'm not sexist. And I'm not saying that to clout chase or to simp or any of that. I truly don't think that way. All right? I if you've got a great idea, you got a great idea. I don't just dismiss it because you're a woman. So we got to go. All right, we got to go. We'll be back tomorrow. I think Simeon Hall's coming in. All right, we're going to talk with Chef. All right, so you guys take care out there and have a great day, Bahamas.